Our youngsters wanting to fly the coop seem to be gone. In fact, a new study by the Australian Institute of Family Studies has crunched the numbers, and a whopping 43% of our children between the ages of 20 and 24 are still living in the family home.
So is this a trend towards togetherness or just a reflection of our economy? And what does that mean for the parents who are left footing the bill?
And demographer Mark McCrindle joins us live in the studio with us today. Hi, Mark. Good to see you again. Why are we seeing more kids staying at home seemingly well into their 20s?
Yeah, in fact, into their early 30s, this study showed. I mean, men, young men, 10%, 1 in 10, 30 to 34-year-olds are still living with their parents. So that's pretty phenomenal. What starts in the 20s does extend, and one of the key reasons is the cost of living. I mean, it is harder to get your own place, either renting or certainly getting a mortgage and getting started in life than used to be the case. But also, they're investing more in education. So they're on that learning conveyor belt a bit longer before they start the earning compared to their parents.
Right.
But then why is it that the men are outnumbering the women in this study?
Well, that's right. I mean, it's been another big social trend. It used to be that men left the family home,
yes,
mainly for work reasons. Now they're delaying the work, so that's one reason. Women, the young women, used to stay at home until they were married. Mm. Now it's actually the young women that are leaving, showing the way of being independent, even above young men in Australia.
Yeah. What does it mean for the parents, this failure to launch? Is this having an impact on the parents?
It is having a bit of a financial cost, sometimes a hidden cost, because these young people are consuming extra electricity. You know, the cost of living is greater for the
food.
Family. Food,
yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
The family car, petrol, not refilling it, you know. But even beyond that, the parents could perhaps downsize. There's an opportunity cost in keeping, maintaining a bigger house than they need because the kids are just hanging around.
That's interesting. Now, the study's also got some numbers around marriage. So even though we've doubled our population, we're seeing less people tie the knot. Why is that?
Exactly. This marriage rate is half what it was 50
yeah.
years ago. It's quite phenomenal. It's partly because we've had a big rise in de facto relationships. So, you know, there's no extra advantage for marriage itself legally these days, of course. And in fact, the data shows that 4 in 5 couples who do end up marrying were living together prior to marriage anyway. So marriage is just sort of an extra step these days, is the perception of Australians, rather than the start of life together. And so because it's an option rather than the start of, you know, the couplehood, we've seen that rate consistently drop now for decades.
So what does that mean on the negative end, I suppose, with divorce? Have we seen a change in the numbers there?
Yeah, divorce rates are down along with marriage rates. So, you know, a positive there. And indeed, if we think about a divorce, that's obviously the end of a marriage. It's not tracked the end of a de facto relationship. And so those that are choosing marriage really are, you know, believing in the institution of marriage. They're really considering it. And so for that reason alone, the divorce rates are down, because those who are choosing to get married are really committed to it.
Yeah, okay. Now, the number of children that we're having has also dropped. It's the lowest rate on record. So what does that say?
Well, we're delaying all of these milestones from marriage to leaving home and also childbirth.
Yeah.
If we go back to the parents of the young women of today, you know, they were having children in their late 20s on average. Now we've shifted into the early 30s. In fact, over the last 10 years, the only age group that have seen an increase in birth numbers have been in the 30s and indeed, you know, late 30s. So that's where the trend is towards having children, and that's why we're having fewer children. A lot of people are running out of time or just delaying it or having smaller families because they're not really starting the family years until their 30s.
Yeah, so Mark, when you consider all of what we've spoken about here, do we need to worry about some of these studies that have come out?
Well, I think we've just adapted to the new way. You know, family structures have changed, the lifestyles, the life stages have changed, and clear reasons for that. You know, people need to get the money together before they start a family. It's a bit harder to get the house, so they delay it all. It's just responding to the new realities, investing in their own education for their future, taking the long-term view rather than just the 20s as a time to get married, start a family and buy a home.
Do you see that trend continuing, though?
Well, there are some natural limits to how late people can push the family-bearing years.
Yep.
So probably we're at the upper end as we move into those early to mid-30s. But, you know, there are some downsides of this. You know, we end up with an ageing population because we're not having enough kids. Those kids that we do have get a bit too reliant on the parents and so perhaps don't form their own independence and relying on their own parents later. So, you know, these are just the changes that we see, pluses and minuses to it all.
Yeah, research that I'm sure affects a lot of our viewers today, Mark. So thanks for shedding some light on it for sure.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll be back with more in just a moment.